Howdy, folks. I'm John Hart Asher. The past few years have been really hard on our trees. Aside from February's freeze, lack of consistent ground soaking rain has felled a lot of our shade producing trees that also provide vital wildlife habitat. In addition, many have been impacted by growing construction in our urban areas. So today, TreeFolks Executive Director Andrew Smiley and Education Coordinator Colin McMichael keep Austin rooted to combat the urban heat island effect and tree canopy inequality. Great to see you both.
Yeah, thanks for having us here. Really appreciate the opportunity to share a little info about keeping Austin rooted.
Wonderful. Well, Andrew, let's start with you first. Who or what is TreeFolks?
3 million trees over 30 years. That's,
wow.
Yeah, that's TreeFolks' big accomplishment. And of course, we started as a very small community-based organization. A group of friends were talking about how can we help save the world? How can we locally address climate change? And as a result of that conversation, they decided to plant trees. And they planted trees in their yards. They planted trees in their neighbors' yards, at schools and other public spaces. And once they built up a bit of momentum, the city of Austin and Austin ISD and other entities really took notice and started supporting TreeFolks and that mission to plant more trees. But it's also about building community. So for the first 20 years of our existence, we really focused on mobilizing the community to plant and care for trees. And of course, education was a big part of that too.
All right. Well, Colin, we hear a lot about the heat island effect, especially, you know, it is a plague to urban areas and has a big impact to human health and well-being, especially on, you know, minority populations. How does the urban canopy make a difference? And what is really that significance of tree inequality?
Well, here in Austin, urban canopy is not really distributed equally across the entire city. So we see a lot more trees in West Austin, where we have a more affluent population. And in East Austin, where we have a more historically underserved population, we don't really have any canopy at all. And the thing there is that the trees really help with urban heat island effects. So urban heat island effects come around because there's low albedo, there's high thermal bulk in the building materials. So cities heat up. If you shade those things though with tree canopy, then they don't heat up as much during the day. So we found, well, not us, but people have found, there was a study recently done by, I think it was Concordia University. If you hit the 40% canopy covered threshold, then temperatures tend to drop 10 degrees. And that's on a block by block scale. So it's very localized. So we're really trying to bump it up to that 40% threshold in East Austin so that we can actually get all the ecosystem benefits that those people need. We're talking cooler temperatures, less noise, just more green space, better health outcomes, stuff like that.
Let's just start with the basics. So when is the best time to plant a tree in Central Texas?
So we say it's October 1st to March 31st. That's what we call tree planting season. So Texas Arbor Day is going to be November 5th, and that's a great day to put a tree in the ground. So really, it's anytime your tree starts to go dormant, that's when it needs to go in the ground. That's awesome. That gives it plenty of time to kind of establish roots throughout the winter, and it'll flush with leaves in the spring and be super happy. Some trees, like citrus and some stuff that's marginally in zone, that's going to be better if you wait until March or kind of late into the planting season, just because it'll have to deal with less cold weather.
Okay. And I want to ask a specific question, and this might sound loaded, but I promise it's a real question, because, you know, what's your favorite tree, but what are really some of those good performers for some of this shade? Because there's a lot of tree and not all trees are the same. So what are the ones that you really feel are key players for y'all?
The top three in Austin, the most common trees in Austin, are going to be the ash juniper, which everyone hates. I love them though. Cedar elm, which are completely indestructible. And then live oak. The live oak thing, we don't really super encourage people to plant a lot more live oaks just because oak wilt is kind of a problem and there's already a lot of live oaks. There's plenty of other oaks that you can plant. I don't really suggest red oaks because we have a lot of those too, but chinkapins, bur oaks, even the Mexican white oaks do really well up here.
The takeaway is that we want diversity, right? We want species diversity because we have one species that we're planting. If we have another snowpocalypse or some pathogen comes through and wipes out all those, well, if we have that diversity, then it might only affect a small percentage of that population.
Yeah, and actually we have some like diversity benchmarks that we try to hit when we're doing planting projects. It's called the 30-20-10 rule, actually. It's 30% from one family, 20% from one genus, and 10% from one species. You can't go over those numbers. So if you're hitting that, that's the right diversity that we're looking for. It's really hard to do in Texas though, because our forests, we have way more oaks than most people have. We just have mostly oaks in our forests. So we really have heightened oak diversity in our planting projects more than we would ideally like to do, but we're working on it.
There's also the understory tree. So those are canopy, but you can team those up with me, you know, maybe some of those. We tend to think big, but we need to think in layers, right? So maybe the red buds or Mexican plums or some other guys that can when stack in there and give you maybe even some more density.
Yeah, we talk about shade all the time, but really those canopy layers that come under the top canopy is, they're so important. The more layers you have, the more productive your forest tends to be and the more benefits you get from that forest. So things are blooming at different times. They're bringing in different kinds of wildlife. Trees cool by kind of transpiring water out of the leaves. So it actually cools the air around it. And the more layers of leaves you have before the ground, that's more cooling that comes down.
If somebody lives in a smaller space, has a smaller yard or something, what would you suggest for some trees for those folks?
We have tons of small trees, actually, because Texas, it's so dry here. There's a lot of little tiny trees. We actually get made fun of at forestry conferences for that all the time. They say bushes. So I love some of these really tried and true trees. So like red buds, I really like the Texas and Mexican red buds. This Eastern red bud doesn't really do that well here. And then we also have some stuff like the Texas mountain laurel. Fantastic for small areas. They grow really, really slowly. So it makes it even better. But there's some oddballs too, which I really like. So if you want to increase the diversity, I suggest planting an oddball. Anacacho orchid trees are really, really cool. They bloom white like an orchid. It's really pretty. There's rusty blackhaw viburnum, which is a really interesting tree. It has super shiny leaves and like tortoiseshell bark. And it has little black berries that taste like black currants. So it's a food plant.
I'm going to throw out my own that I'm a little biased towards. Also the Blanco crab apple. I think it's a beautiful tree and it's something that's endangered because of overgrazing. So if you can get one, that's a super duper
one. They are hard to find though. So if you can find one, tell everyone you know.
Well, plant nerds, start searching. Let's talk about the absolute sort of basic planting tips and tricks. If somebody, I don't know anything about a tree, but I've listened to you and by darn it, I'm going to plant a tree. All right, what do we do?
All right, so there's definitely a bunch of stuff that you should do to maximize your success and then some stuff that you just like have to do.
Right.
So the first thing to do to kind of maximize your success, water the tree before you even start the project. So it's in the pot, it's sitting right there. You haven't dug the hole yet. Just water it. It's going to really, it's going to loosen the root ball. The tree's going to be happier. The root's going to be more supple. The tree's going to be much happier that way. So then it's time to dig your hole. And you have to dig the hole twice as wide as the pot is. That's really important because backfilling the hole is an important thing. You have to loosen that dirt so the roots can kind of spread out. But a lot of people dig the hole as deep as the pot. And that's usually a huge problem. So one of the biggest problems in urban tree planting is that they're too deep. So trees in their pots are often 2 to 5 inches too deep already. And that's to kind of prevent weeds from growing in the pot. So once you get that tree out of the pot, get all the dirt off so you can find the first root. And that's how much dirt should be on top of that tree. And then you need to kind of tease the roots out really well. And they can take a lot of beating. So kind of comb the roots out, make sure you can spread them out in the hole. And then make sure that tree is on the right level. So I like to put a shovel across the hole. So you have like a bar. And so you want that root flare to be an inch or 2 inches above the shovel. So it should be, the root flare should be above the soil line. And so you backfill and then mulch on top of that. So then the mulch should level it so that you then have root flare level with the soil.
But you don't want mulch all the way up flush against the base of the trunk, right?
That's correct. So you want your mulch to be like 2 to 4 inches away from the trunk. Mulch should never touch your tree. It should only touch dirt.
No mulch canos, people. No mulch canos. A lot of people, when they plant trees, they say, you know what? I'm going to buy that big old honking tree that's been in a pot for 15 years because it's an instant tree. Is that really a great thing to do? Or if you plant a younger tree, that it's probably going to catch up with that tree, that big tree, and surpass it in that same time.
It's really counterintuitive. You're completely correct. The sapling is going to overtake the 5-gallon tree every time. It's because when trees grow, they're not used to really changing spots. So their roots are adapted to that soil. As soon as you change spots for the tree, it has to grow new roots that are adapted to new soil. So all those old roots, they don't really work well. So the little baby tree, it doesn't really have to replace a lot of roots. It only has like 5. It's the one that has to replace 50 that's not going to do that well. I didn't believe this at all when I started at TreeFolks. I was like, that's not true. There's no way that's going to happen. I got a few saplings. I got a few 5-gallon trees. I planted them. It's 3 years later now. The saplings are 8 to 9 feet tall. The 5-gallon trees have barely grown.
Ah, wow.
I mean, they've grown. It's definitely growing. Yeah. It's not 9 feet tall.
Not only are you providing all this information for free, where can people go to get a free tree from TreeFolks, and who qualifies for the free trees?
It's really easy. So any Austin resident or Austin Energy customer qualifies for a free 5-gallon tree from TreeFolks. Yeah. So just go to our website. You can go to www.treefolks.org/NW. And that takes you to our Neighbor Woods programmatic page. And that's where you're going to sign up to get a free tree. And there should be like a tree menu, and that'll help you make your decisions. It's a really great site. There's also options for reforestation, and you can also find that through our website.
You know, people are only going to protect what they know and love what they know. So education always fundamental in conservation, preservation, and restoration. I've interacted with y'all's organization a number of times. Y'all have not only had a presence in Austin, but large-scale restoration. You worked post the 2011 drought wildfires and the 2015 Blanco River flood.
Following the 2011 wildfires in Bastrop, TreeFolks was tapped to help lead the reforestation effort there, in part because we had a good background, a good knowledge of the technical tree planting side of things, but also because we had the ability to mobilize community and to connect with residents in that healing process. Our successes there in Bastrop, which are still ongoing, by the way, we're still distributing trees in Bastrop. But that also brought us into the restoration, the reforestation along the Blanco River after that 2015 flood. Again, because of the tree planting expertise, getting folks involved in the tree planting, the healing process, and also the landowner education component that was really key to creating those long-term stewards. That big reforestation work is what has launched our current large-scale reforestation, where we're working in a 6-county region to plant trees along riparian areas in floodplains, really to try to get out ahead of the next disaster, and also to generate carbon credits that we trade with the city and other partners.
If people are interested in doing some of this wonderful work that y'all do, how in the world can they get involved this fall?
You know, it's tree folks for a reason. The trees are important, the folks even more so, maybe. We have volunteer opportunities that folks can find online at treefolks.org. So we love having families out, scout groups, service organizations, school groups, corporate partners, whoever can come plant a tree. Obviously, there's opportunity to donate and support TreeFolks work in that way as well.
Sure.
And we're always looking for more tree stewards, folks to learn more about trees and just take care of the ones they see in their neighborhood.
Great. Have you ever thought about hiring an army of squirrels? Because I know that I have more trees that pop up my yard because of squirrels. Just throwing that out there.
You know, we hadn't really thought about it, but but you're right. They could definitely help help expand our pecan orchards.
Thank you so much, Andrew and Colin. It's been super duper talking to y'all. Really love y'all's organization and all the great work you're doing. And I just want to thank you again for all the viewers, because y'all are just a whole heaping bunch full of information. Keep out there planting trees, and we'll see you in the wild.